What's going on, fellow musician? Welcome back to another producer's channel where I share videos about making music on a low budget in your home studio. And in my last video about my new home studio, I covered how you can find the optimal listening position in your room. And in today's video, we're going to focus on improving the room acoustics. I built some broadband absorbers to get rid of this reverb, and yeah, as you can hear, it somehow worked a little bit already. These DIY absorbers are quite easy to build and rather inexpensive. And as you can see, I set up three of them in this U-shape here to record the voiceover. Let me know what you think about it in the comment section below. If you want to build one of these absorbers yourself, here is a list of all the materials that you need for one absorber.
As a frame for the porous material, you need one IKEA bookshelf. Using this IKEA bookshelf is a well-known method. However, you could also build the frame yourself. But for 25 euros, I thought it would be easier, and it probably also looks better than if I built it myself. To cover your absorbers, you need a fabric that is flame retardant and air permeable. I used high quality satin molten, so most likely you can buy the fabric only in certain increments. Depending on how many absorbers you want to build, you can use such a calculator to determine how much fabric you need. I had fabric that was 3 meters wide and could be ordered in 1 meter increments. For the upper part of the absorber, a 125 by 80 cm piece of fabric should be enough, and for the lower part you need a 85 by 80 cm piece. I built 6 absorbers, that means I ordered 5 meters of fabric. For the absorbent material, I used rock wool, although you could also use glass wool, for example. But you don't just want to use any mineral wool. I bought panels that are about 60 centimeters wide and 1 meter high, so they fit perfectly into the top compartment of the shelf. It should also be flame retardant, and the most important value is the flow resistivity. As I use 2 layers of 10 centimeter thick material, I have an absorber depth of 20 centimeters. That is why I chose a material with a rather low flow resistivity of 6000 pascal seconds per square meter to absorb more of the lower frequencies. If you build a thinner absorber, you might want to use a material with a higher flow resistivity, since it is more effective with less depth. My absorbers cannot stand directly at the wall, that's why I have a small gap of 2 cm from the absorber to the wall. This has a positive effect on the amount of absorption. So build the absorbers as thick as possible, and if you have more space available, then move them a little bit away from the wall to achieve some bonus absorption. You can also test out your own values with this calculator, which I highly recommend. Next on the list are battens and staples. All that really matters here is that the frame is wide enough to staple the fabric tight and that it doesn't extend too far into the shelf. I used wooden slats with a width of 3.8 cm and a depth of 2.4 cm. This was pretty much perfect because the shelf is about 23 cm deep and the mineral wool already takes up 20 cm. As with the fabric, you can use a calculator to figure out the optimal number of slats you need for the number of absorbers you want to build. For each absorber, you need 4 pieces with the inner width of the shelf, which is 56.8 cm. You also need 2 pieces with the inner height of the upper shelf and 2 more with the inner height of the lower shelf. Here you must not forget to subtract the width of the wood twice, because you already have a piece of wood at the top and at the bottom. The top shelf is 102.1 cm high and the bottom shelf is 66.3 cm high. As I already said, I used wooden slats with a width of 3.8 cm, so I cut the slats for the top shelf to 94.5 cm and the slats for the bottom shelf to 58.7 cm. Since I built 6 absorbers, I needed 12 of each of the longer timbers and 24 of the timbers for the width. You could even print this out and hand it over to the person in the DIY store in case you don't want to cut it yourself. Last but not least, you also need at least 16 screws for the frame. Some more if you also want to fixate it within the shelf. Here's also a list of tools that I used and you might also need. With that out of the way, let's start building. The first thing I did was to build the bookshelves with the help of my beautiful girlfriend. Here it is important that you build only the basic frame without the loose shelves and the back wall. Actually, such an IKEA shelf should be simple to assemble. Nevertheless, here is a short video of how we did it. Afterwards, I built the frames for the fabric. For this, I first marked the width of the wooden slats on the lower and upper slats and then drilled two holes with the smallest drill I had. Here I just went by eye and placed the two holes about evenly from each other. Of course, you can do this more accurately. After that, I clamped the wide and the long batten in the angle clamp and screwed them together. I did the same on all four corners. My angle clamp isn't actually designed for this and I could only ever tighten one screw while the wood was clamped, so I always tightened the second screw afterwards, still making sure that the surface on which the fabric would later rest was flat. Whenever a frame was ready, I tested to see if it would fit into the shelf. If the frame does not quite fit, it is helpful if you have some sandpaper or a sander. When assembling the frame, you should make sure that the surface on which the fabric is to rest later is even. For me, this has not always worked, which is why I have helped a little with the grinder. Speaking of the fabric, of course, it has to be cut to size. I put a finished frame on the fabric and cut the fabric with about a 10 centimeter distance to the frame. Here you should watch out if the wood resins, because that can dirty your fabric and you can't really get the tree resin out of the fabric very well. Once you have the fabric and the frame ready, it is time to cover it. And you should look for help here because the fabric must be pulled tightly from both sides. First, we attach the fabric centered on all opposite sides with staples. Then we cut out unnecessary fabric in the corners, which would have otherwise become too thick when folded. Here, however, you don't just cut out a square, but leave a flap that will later cover the wood at the corner when it's folded in this way. Always stretch the fabric from both sides and fasten it from the middle of the wooden slats to the outside. We rotated the frame, but you might want to move yourself rather than the frame. And don't worry about minor wrinkles. If you work from the inside out and always pull tight, all wrinkles should be gone by the end. Before you get too close to the corners, however, you need to fold in the flap and staple it down. Then you can also pull the fabric tight at the corners and fasten it. When you have finished stretching the fabric on the frame, you can cut off the excess fabric. Then it's time to put it in place. Here it helps if you slant the frame a little. With the fabric on the edges, the frame should fit very snugly, so light taps on the edge are a good way to get the frame into the desired position. If you want to, you can attach the frame to the shelf with additional screws. Instead of starting with the front, you could also start with the back wall and the rock wall. But since the frames were not so easy to put in, I decided to put them in first. The consequence, of course, is that you can't just press the rock wall into the shelf later when filling it because the fabric will bulge. Since we are talking about rock wall now, unfortunately, you will need to cut that for the bottom shelf, and for that you will need a mask, gloves and a bread knife. When cutting rock wool, it is a good idea to go outside, as this is a really itchy material and the small particles that are swirled through the air when cutting are really unhealthy. You can also theoretically add trickle protection to the absorbers if you are concerned about the particles. Simple garden fleece is a good and cheap choice for this. I marked the height of the bottom compartment and then cut the rock wool accordingly. Coincidentally, two of the leftover pieces filled the bottom compartment exactly, so I only had to cut 8 times. Filling the shelves is not quite so simple as the rock wool panels are a bit too wide and therefore have to be stuffed into the compartment without the fabric bulging at the front. Once the shelves are filled, they still need to be closed. To do this, nail the back panel to the shelf with the wide side facing out. And then you're done. Now let's see how it improved the room acoustics in my room. To measure and visualize the room acoustics, I used the free software Room EQ Wizard. Here you can see two measurements I made when there was no acoustic treatment in the room. As you can see, between 50 Hz and 1000 Hz and between 5K and 20K, there are some peaks and valleys. If we now add the two measurements with room acoustics treatment, the green and the yellow line, we see that especially here in the highs, the frequency response is nicely flattened. The peak at about 650 Hz is somehow inverted now, and also the peak at about 130 Hz has decreased significantly. This large valley could also be corrected a little bit, however it is below 100 Hz and as we saw at the beginning of the video, the absorption decreases significantly there. I generated an average for both the first and the second measurements. If you'd look at them with psychoacoustic smoothing, you can also clearly see the improvements in the highs and at 130 Hz. Only apparently the valley at 85 has become even larger, and at about 600 Hz a new dip has appeared where previously there was a peak. In addition to the frequency response, the reverberation time is also crucial since I also wanted to minimize the room reverberation. For comparison, let's take a look at a waterfall diagram that visualizes the reverberation time. Here you can see the waterfall diagram of my last measurement. If you now overlay the waterfall diagram of the first measurement without room acoustic improvement, you can see that almost over the entire frequency spectrum, the blue overpowers the yellow. This means that the reverberation time was significantly higher before the improvement. You can take a closer look at this in the spectrogram. Here you'd look at the waterfall diagram from above and see how long each frequency decays. This is the room without treatment, and this is the room with treatment. Already a clear difference, isn't it? But to put the whole thing in perspective, in a professional recording room you want to have an RT60 of less than 300 milliseconds. RT60 is the time it takes for an audio signal to drop by 60 dB. To visualize this, I adjust the range scale to 60 dB, so now everything above 300 milliseconds is theoretically too much reverberation time. The fact that there is so much reverberation up to 1 second could have something to do with the low test volume. Maybe someone of you knows more about this and can let me know if I made a mistake in my measurements. However, that shouldn't change the fact that there shouldn't be reverberation times higher than 300 milliseconds in a standardized room.
Of course, as you can hear, it's still reverberant and there's certainly so much more to improve here. Unfortunately, the absorbers don't go all the way up to the ceiling, and the ceiling itself offers a large area for reverberation. However, I think these 6 absorbers alone have already improved the room acoustics a lot, so I can definitely recommend them if you want to build them yourself. By the way, if you didn't like this video yet, please do so now as a small compensation for what my girlfriend had to go through. Thank you very much. I hope you stay healthy and I will see you in the next one. Until then, have an absolutely awesome time.